What's poppin', people? What's poppin'? What's poppin'? What's poppin'? What's poppin'? What's poppin'? How y'all doing, man? What is up, Spit? Hello, hello, hello. Hope you guys are well. Got some people tuning in. Man, today was a beautiful, beautiful day. And as you can see, I got some stun. Got some stun. Oh, someone says, nice stash. You see the stash? I didn't choose the stash. The stash chose me, people. I got to show you my inspiration for the stash. I definitely have an inspiration for the stash. He's an amazing, amazing person. There you go. I'll show you my inspiration for the stash. His name is Carl Winslow, people. Carl Winslow. And he is Reginald V. Johnson. Look. That's my future, people. That right there is my future. The stash. Do you see this? Anyway, that's it, man. I'm going to be, somebody told me I look like an officer. And I said to that, I said, you know what? You're under arrest. You know, so the stash chose me. Chose me, people. Anyway, I'm excited. Hey, by the way, there is no Zoom call tonight. We've decided to put the Zoom calls on hold, but all your small groups, every single one of your small groups has a Zoom call. So please check those out. It's in the link tree. Your small group has a Zoom call, and that's what we're doing right now. So we're not having a spin Zoom call at the end of the night because there are so many other Zoom calls going on. But I love you guys, and man, I got a word tonight. We're in a series. We're starting a brand new series. I'm going to pull up the logo for you right now. Actually, it's right here. Can I cast this? Ba-bow! You guys see that right there? Emmanuel. This is our brand new series that we're starting. And I'm super pumped about it. I absolutely love that we can start a series even when we're not together. Emmanuel, that's a new series we're going into. And man, I'm super excited about it. Anyway, let me go ahead and jump off. This series is something that the Lord has kind of been stirring in my heart as I think about everything that's going on in this season, kind of what we're facing as a nation. The numbers continue to rise. Even though in some parts of the country people are getting better, still it's getting worse for some people. Over somewhere between 6 to 8 million Americans have lost their jobs, students, and we're constantly getting information from everywhere. And so as I was praying for you, as I was saying, God, what do you want me to say in the midst of this series? Like, what do you want me to say in the midst of this moment to our students and to our leaders? And I came across the thought of Emmanuel. The Holy Spirit reminded me, that's what he does, of what God has already spoken to me. And so the Lord brought the phrase Emmanuel back to my heart. And this series, I want you to know, is written for the person who feels like no one cares. It's written for the person who feels isolated. It's written for the person who feels lonely. It's written for the person who isn't excited about the relationship with God. And this is written for the person who feels like, man, they're disconnected from their faith. I believe God wants to speak to you today. And man, the word Emmanuel, it means God with us, which is so strange to the people of the Old Testament. Because here's the deal. The people in the Old Testament, they didn't know that the future was going to be like this. We're living in what is called their preferred future, right? They didn't know that one day it wouldn't just be God speaking to us from the heavens, but that one day Jesus would be walking around the earth with us. And then to go even farther, the people of the Old Testament, yo, they couldn't even imagine, like they couldn't even comprehend the fact that God wouldn't just live among us or with us, but that he would live on the inside of us. God with us, God presently with us. And man, this was shown so clearly to the prophet Isaiah and then confirmed in the New Testament when Jesus pulls up on the earth and John the Baptist calls out to them and said, look, it's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Boom, John the Baptist, man, is like, that is the word, the physical word of God. Anyway, this series is so pivotal, so important for you to understand, because it does not matter where you're at, what you're going through, or what's shaking your life, God is with you. He is present in our midst. Anyway, I want to share with you Jeremiah 29:10-11. Jeremiah 29:10-11. It says, This is God's word on the subject, right? As soon as let me stop real quick. This is God's word on the subject. The reason that Jeremiah 29, 10, and 11, it's really famous verses. The reason that they were written is because the people of God were enslaved to this nation called Babylon. The Lord allowed Babylon to overtake his people because they were unfaithful to God. They were doing some weird, crazy stuff on the side, and God's like, chill. This is really weird. I'm going to allow you guys to be consumed by these people because you guys aren't paying attention to me. You're not listening to what I'm telling you. You're serving other gods. So Jeremiah 29, 10, 11, it says, this is God's word on the subject. As soon as Babylon's 70 years are up and not a day before, I'll show up and take care of you. As I promised you, I'll bring you back home. I know what I'm doing, says God. I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not abandon you. Plans to give you the future you hope for. Plans to give you the future that you hope for. So again, Israel is enslaved to this nation called Babylon. And Jeremiah is writing. God's using Jeremiah to write some encouraging words to the people of God who are in crisis. Yo, this situation is super familiar to the situation we find ourselves in, where the people of God are in crisis. And so today, as I was reading this, I want to give you three things to think about as you think about Emmanuel, God being with us. Three things I want to give you today. Here's the first one. Is write this down. God has a word for every wilderness I'm in. God has a word for every wilderness you find yourself in. There is a word, that is the key word, a word for every wilderness you find yourself in. The Bible says this. God says, this is God's word on the subject, right? Paul's speaking to the church in the book of Corinthians. He's writing to the church to help them understand where he's getting all this wisdom from. And he says, this is God's word. He said, as soon as Babylon's poverty, oh, I'm sorry, this is what Paul says. He says, every word we speak to you was taught to us by God. So Paul's like, listen, I'm not coming up with this stuff on my own. Everything I'm sharing with you came to me from God. Every season you're in, God has a word for that season. Every situation you're in, God has a word for that situation. Paul's writing to the church and he's like, listen, every word I spoke to you, man, it was by God's spirit, not by human wisdom. And this same spirit helps teach us things to spiritual people. So Paul's like, listen, this is me helping you understand that when I say these amazing things, they're not coming from me. He calls it a word from God. Now, here's what's really interesting. Jesus is called the Word of God. So when I say that there is a word for every wilderness, what I'm talking about is that Paul is saying that you and I, that word that he spoke, and what the prophet Jeremiah said, God's word on the subject, bro, that's Jesus. It's Jesus who is the word in the wilderness. When I say that to you, what I'm physically talking about is God being with you in the middle of everything that you're going through. Listen to me, Spin. There is nothing that you're going to go through that God is not going to be with you on, right? Every single season, every situation in your life, God says, I have something great for you in the middle of this. I'm speaking to you. He has something to give you. And that word is Jesus, man. I'll tell you right now that the Bible tells us to keep in Colossians to set our sights on the realities of heaven. Why? Because Jesus is there. Can I tell you, one day when we get to heaven, what makes heaven so exciting is not that we're just going to be on streets of gold. Some of you are pop locking. You're like, hey, no more sin. What's exciting about it is the fact that we're with Jesus. But here's the thing. Jesus is with us right now. He is our Emmanuel. Let me give you another thought through this scripture. Is I serve a God who loves taking care of me. I serve a God who loves taking care of me. It literally says this. God says, I'll show up and take care of you. I'll show up and take care of you. Now some of you are saying, like, Pastor Peter, I hear what you're saying. I just don't feel like God shows up when I'm going through difficult times. I don't feel like he's taking care of me, right? But let me tell you right now, you don't have to necessarily feel like God is taking to you. Trust me, he is. God is not like that kid who gets an A on his test for the first time and is like, oh my gosh, look at what I did. Look, see what I accomplished. He doesn't need you to know what he's accomplishing, but you've got to know, man, that this world is dark and that it's difficult, and the fact that you're safe, the fact that you're provided for, the fact that everything is okay for you. It might not be perfect, but it's okay, shows you that God is in fact taking care of you.
Man, just that language, I'll show up. Do you understand that every other religion, every other belief is not about our God showing up to us. It's about us having to earn the love and the respect and the admiration of these gods. But our God, Jesus Christ says, I'll show up. I'll take care of you, right? Like right now, my little daughter, she's walking around with all these different baby dolls. And we got her all types of baby dolls. We got black baby dolls and white baby dolls, and we're trying to get different color baby dolls because we're trying to have the United Nations in our house. You know what I'm saying, people? But the way she cares for these babies, she watches what we do for her little brother, and she feeds him, right? She holds a little bottle to his lips. She takes care of him, right? She's constantly looking all day long. Baby, baby. Actually, she can't pronounce her B, so she's like, baby, baby, baby. And I think she's calling for me, but she's actually looking for her baby, right? She has these babies, and she's taking care of them. And she understands that as someone who owns this, it's her responsibility to take care of these babies. But God, but think about God. Man, we are his responsibility. We're designed and crafted in his image. You never have to worry if God is going to take care of you. You serve a God who loves taking care of you. The Bible says that he knows the amount of hairs on your head, that he knows your heart. He sees where you are. He loves taking care of you. One of my favorite verses in scripture right now is written in James, and it says, tell God what you need and thank him for all that he's done. And you're thinking to yourself, yo, why do I have to tell a God who knows everything what I'm thankful for, or to tell him what I did? Look, my dogs are in the back saying amen. Like, why do I have to tell God what I need if he already knows everything about me? And it's because God wants you to list out what you need so that you can receive. Man, I need help. And it's when you know that you need help that God will begin to help you, that he'll begin to intervene in your life, that he'll begin to come after you. Listen, you serve a God who loves taking care of you. A lot of people don't pray right now. A lot of people aren't praying because they're going, man, I don't want to overwhelm God. I feel like I keep asking for the same things. No, no, no. Don't get it twisted. He loves you coming towards him. He loves you asking. He loves you spending time with him. He loves you. I serve a God who loves taking care of me. So point number one, God has a word for every wilderness I'm facing. Point number two, I serve a God who loves taking care of me. And point number three, God has a plan for my future, which means he's aware of my present. Did you catch that? God has a plan for my future, which means he's aware of my present. Okay? For God to speak and to say, hey, listen, I got a plan for you to give you the future that you hope for, what he's saying to you is, listen, I'm able to tell you where your life is going because I know exactly where you are right now. Yo, that brings so much confidence to my spirit that God is shaping my future, that he knows exactly where I'm going. I actually had a moment like this with my parents one time where, you know, it's so funny. Like, as a student, I was the kind of student that, like, my mom would tell me something and I'm like, yeah, I got you. And so one time my parents got me this Bible as a gift, and they were like, yo, would you read the Bible? And I was like, yo, I already read the Bible, and I had another Bible that I liked using, and or I would just use it on my phone. And you know, anyway, my parents put money in this Bible, but they kept telling me, Peter, would you read the Bible? Would you read the Bible? I'm like, I am. I'm doing it. And I remember asking my dad for money one time. I'm like, yo, I need $100 to get these pair of shoes. And he's like, just go read your Bible. My mom, can I get some money? Go read your Bible. I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm reading the Bible. It was literally not until 3 years later, people. Imagine how angry I was. 3 years later, I open up this Bible, and here, boom, smack in the middle is the money that I was asking for what I wanted 3 years ago. My parents wanted me to open up God's word to receive a physical gift that they planted there for me, right? Boom, Karen said money in my Bible, I receive it. They planted money in there physically for me to receive a physical blessing for opening up my spiritual word. But that's what happens in scripture, is like literally that exact principle is what it is, what God has called us to when he says, listen, I have plans set out for your future. I know where you're at. Would you just do what I'm asking? Pastor Peter, how does that relate? Because when you allow yourself, when you open up the word of God, there's a treasure waiting inside there for you. There's something waiting there for you that God wants to give you, and he knows where he's sending you. Dude, this gives me so much clarity, because right now I feel like all of us are spending so much time planning our future, prepping our future, putting things together, trying to figure things out. And yo, we don't have to do that. We just have to be obedient. We have to be faithful. We have to be locked into what God has called us to do. He has all of our future planned out. He has everything set aside, everything put together. Here's an interesting thought I had today thinking about this, right? That God has my whole future planned, which means he's aware of my present. It's like if today, right? If LeBron James came up to me and said, Peter, my boy, what's popping? I see the stash. You look good. I'd be like, LeBron, stop. Stop playing with me, LeBron. Stop. Anyway, if LeBron came up to me and said that today, and he said, and I said, hey, LeBron, I don't know what I'm going to do next. I don't know what's going on with my future. And he said, don't worry about it. I got you. Your future is going to be secure. I'm not going to lie to you, people. I don't really know LeBron like that. I don't know if he's trustworthy. I don't know what he's like. But I do know that if he said that to me, I would have a little bit of confidence in the fact that he said my future would be okay because I know how much resources he has. I know that LeBron has the resources to take care of his whole family and my whole family, and we're good, right? Like, I know he has the resources to do that. So if he said that to me, I would feel some sense of confidence. But here's the truth is God is telling you and I, hey, I got your future. I'm good. You don't need to worry. And we're like, I don't know. I don't know, man. This is difficult. Really? You're going to take care of me? What do you mean? He's the one that's created everything and everyone. He knows your future. You don't have to wonder. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to try to put things together. God's got this. Man, this is why this thought, Emmanuel, is so important. This is why Emmanuel is such a big deal. Is that God is not off in the distance. God is not looking far away from you. Emmanuel means that God is with you. So it doesn't matter where you are. Doesn't matter what you're going through. Doesn't matter what the enemy puts against you. God is with you. One of the things that separates people in the Bible from normal people who don't know Jesus is this. Is that it always says that the Lord was with them. That the Lord was with them. Listen, my friends, the Lord is with you. And let me give you one more thought today. A lot of you in this chat right now, looking at this stream, is you're struggling with sin, right? Here's the reality, is you're at home, you have a lot of time, a lot of things are going on, but you're struggling with sin. And I just wanna say, in Spin, we don't think that sin is okay. We absolutely hate sin, but we love the sinner. And this phrase, Emmanuel, is so powerful. Because when I hear it and it says God is with us, what do we know about God? We know that God cannot be around sin. Sin and God cannot coexist in the same atmosphere. God despises sin. He can never go near sin. He's never been sinful. Jesus lived his life 33 years on this earth and never sinned. And so as we consider sin and God's relationship, there is no relationship with them. But then God looks at you and I who are sinners and he says, I'll be with you. Emmanuel, God with us right now in the presence. You say, Pastor Peter, why is that so important? It means that God will never allow your sin to stick with you. Why? Because he knows, man, I can't be with you if sin is a part of you. So God consistently on, the Bible tells us every morning there's new mercy for you and I. Sin and God can't coexist. So when God says to you and I, I'll be with you, what he's saying is sin will never have a hold on your life. Sin will never keep you away from me. Sin will never keep you bound. I have a plan. I have a hope. I have something great in store for you. Emmanuel, God with us. This isn't just about Christmas time. This is about the God who's present in our midst. He's not far off in the distance. He's not exiled us. He's not isolated us. It does not matter where you are. It does not matter what you're going through. God will be with you. God loves you. God cares about you. And it doesn't matter. Our culture right now is trying to convince us that it's not going to get better, that we're stuck, that all of our hope is in the government. Listen, my hope is not in the government, which is why I don't criticize them. My hope is not in man, which is why I don't criticize man. My hope is not in our governor. My hope is in God Almighty, students. Your hope is in God Almighty. Man, and we're those kind of people. Man, I see it right now. We walk with a different level of confidence. We have a different kind of swag to us. We have a different kind of faith to us. We have a different kind of belief to us. Why? Because we trust and believe in God, Emmanuel with us. So when you close your eyes, understand you're never alone. You're never alone. You're not isolated. You're not exiled. You're not broken. God is with you. Woo! That's been setting me free today. It's been setting me free. But to the person who feels like no one cares, to the person who feels like no one cares, God is with you. To the person who feels like they're isolated, God is with you. To the person who feels lonely, to the person who feels forgotten about, God is with you. To the person who isn't excited about their relationship with God, God is with you. To the person who feels disconnected from their faith, God is with you. We serve a God that isn't just waiting for us to come to Him. He's willing to come to us. That's good news today. That should fire you up today. That should get you excited today that God is with us. Emmanuel. Emmanuel. Look at this picture. It's of a person with their hands on their knees, their arms folded. And when I look at that picture, I see a person who isn't sure how God feels about them. I see a person who maybe has gone through a difficult time or experienced some difficult things. And I want to let you know today that God sees you, that He's covering you, that He cares about you, that you're not alone. The people of the Old Testament couldn't imagine the day that we live in. They couldn't imagine it, where God would not just be among us, but that He would live in us with the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, I'm sorry. I want to pray for you today. I want to pray that though we face difficult times, you wouldn't be shook or alarmed or afraid. I want to pray that there would be some new confidence in your soul, in your spirit. God loves you, Spin family. He's with us. We're doing this thing together. We're not alone. We're not alone. You know what? Even in scripture, in Genesis, there's a story about this dude named Joseph. And Joseph gets falsely accused for something that he didn't do. And it says that wherever Joseph went, God was with him. Emmanuel before Emmanuel, right? Like, it says wherever Joseph went, God was with him. And Joseph was considered prosperous. You know what's so interesting about that? Is Joseph was in prison. Joseph was kicked out by the king. Joseph was chased out by his own family. Joseph was sold for some silver. Joseph had a terrible life in some regards. But it says that he was a prosperous man. Why? Because God considers prosperity not how much money you have, but when His presence is with you. Yo, there's a different kind of currency that rules the earth. And it's not money. There's a currency of heaven. God loves you. He considers you prosperous. He considers you wealthy. Why? Because His presence is with you. This is the God that we serve, Emmanuel. The God that doesn't just call us from afar, but comes close, comes near. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for all my friends. Thank you for these students, God, who are listening in, who know, God, that you're with them. Lord, I pray this week, God, as they go through different moments, both good and bad, that they would be reminded, God, that you're with them, that you see them, that you love them. God, that you consider them prosperous. God, be with us this week. Thank you for all that you've done, for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name. Yo, check this out. This week, I want you to reflect on that word, Emmanuel. I want you to focus in on it. I want you to allow it to become a part of you. That doesn't matter where I'm at, where I'm going, what's going on. God's with me. For a lot of you, even, you're saying, man, I'm struggling with sin. Remember, God doesn't allow that sin to stick to you. He can't, because He's with you. Confess it, get rid of it. Let God have His way in your heart. This week, I want you to reflect on the points. Maybe you don't get enough time to dive into the Word for yourself, even though my number one hope is that you would dive into the Word. But maybe you don't get a chance to dive into the Word. My prayer is that you would reflect on these points again. Number one, God has a Word for every wilderness you find yourself in. Number two, I serve a God who loves taking care of me. And number three, God has a plan for the future, which means He's aware of my present. I love you. Let's believe in Emmanuel. Let's trust our God is with us. Check out the link tree. See when your small group call is. Jump on that small group call and let God speak to you this week. I love you. You guys are amazing, Spin. Peace.